You're not always going to understand God's ways and how God uses authority. You're not. If you need an explanation, you'll never see the beauty of authority. You show me someone who has authority issues, and I'll show you God replacing them with someone else to do what they were supposed to do. We were playing the University of Cincinnati in Cincinnati, packed out arena. And during the game, our coach pulled out of the game one of our players, Purnell. Purnell walks to the bench, and you could tell he was dejected. He and Coach Williams had some choice words. He sat down on the bench. Game still going on. Up and down. Up and down. And suddenly, I looked to my right, and Purnell stood, spun on his heels, walked across the court while the game is going on in front of 12,000 people. He walked through the tunnel that led to our locker room, nowhere to be found. I thought to myself, this is Division I basketball? Where we have an altercation on the bench during the game, and Purnell has walked out of the building. Have you ever pulled a Purnell? You're probably going, no. But you have. So have I. We've all walked away from authority. That wicked walk. I'm talking about that stride of pride. That stroll into Sheol. We pulled a Purnell. We know what's best. We know how to roll. We know how we should play. Who are you to tell me what to do? Authority issues. We've been learning that God is a God of authority. Everything God does is with and through authority. It's like this umbrella. You're either an umbrella fella or not. You're either a princess of the parasol or not. But I'm here to tell you, in our culture, it's so sexy, so hip to pull a Purnell. That stride of pride. I know what's best for me. Whenever I think about authority and authority issues, my mind is quickened to a character in the Bible named Saul, and another one named David. I'm going to tell you four quick stories about their interactions with authority issues. Who was Saul? Saul was the king of Israel, 6 feet 6 inches tall, black hair, handsome, articulate. He was the king of Israel. He was running the military, the finances, everything. He was under, though, the authority of Samuel. Who was Samuel? Samuel was God's prophet, God's man. So you have God, Samuel, and Saul. God always works through authority. Authority is not a bad word. It's a good word. So this was Saul's vibe, you know? This was his jam. This is how he rolled. Story one, I call this whiplash at Micmash. The whiplash at Micmash. Saul was at Micmash, and maybe you feel like you've been in Micmash before. Maybe you're up to your eyeballs in Micmash. Maybe the Micmash has hit the fan. I don't know. You're surrounded by something. Saul was surrounded by the Philistines. Now, the Philistines had a corner on the iron market. They were formidable opponents. The Israelites, they were like Hebrew hillbillies. I mean, they didn't have very much. A couple of rakes and hoes. I'm talking about the garden tool. So they were outnumbered and outmanned. Well, Saul had to do something. Saul had to wait until Samuel, Sam I am, came and did the sacrifices to God before he could enter battle. It's very important. Saul, I mean, he wanted to fight the Philistines. They were so close, he could smell their cologne. Yet he had a morale problem. People were pulling Purnells. They were leaving, walking out. So Saul gets nervous. He's like, man, Samuel's not here yet, so I'm just going to go ahead. I'll just make my own sacrifices. And does it really matter? I mean, I'm just going to do it myself. Samuel is not there yet. Time's running out. Saul does the sacrificial thing. And right after he finished doing the sacrificial thing, who do you think showed up? Samuel. Samuel shows up, and I love what he said in 1 Samuel 13:11. What have you done? Saul was like, oh man, what have I done? What have I done? What have you done? Asked Samuel. And Saul replied, I mean, here's some excuses that I've given before. I've even given these excuses to God. He said, when I saw that the men were scattering, say, I saw, and that you did not come at the set time, which is a lie, and that the Philistines were assembling at Micmash, I thought, say that with me, I thought, now the Philistines will come down against me at Gilgal, and I've not sought the Lord's favor. So I felt compelled to offer the burnt offering. I felt, say, I felt with me. Those are the steps we take when we leave the authority of God. I saw, I thought, I felt. I mean, visually, I know the deal. Mentally, yeah. My feelings, my heart tells me, you know, go with your heart. He should have waited, because God has authority set up in all of our lives for a reason. And to give you just some insight into Saul, if you read about his life, even before this thing went down, his son Jonathan secured this victory for the Israelites. And the Bible says that Saul blew the horn and said, look, Saul has defeated the enemy. You're talking about tooting your own horn. So we see he's having this authority struggle. He thinks it's about himself, and he's trying to throw these excuses up to Samuel. So he experienced a whiplash at Michmash. Story two. Here's my title, The Bite of the Amalekites. The Amalekites, yes, Israel's arch enemy, the Amalekites. The Amalekites were the first people they faced when they entered the promised land. These people were demonic. They were sadistic. And here's what God told Samuel to tell Saul. I'll demonstrate. See the white man overwipe? I just played Wipeout for you. God said, wipe out these people. So Saul was like, okay, I'll do it. They went into battle, and he wiped out about 95% of the Amalekites. I mean, he was 5% short, but you know, whatever. After this victory, you gotta love Saul. Saul went to another place and built a monument of himself. Oh, Ed, I cannot believe the narcissism. I would never do that. Have you ever looked at TikTok or Instagram or Facebook? We're building these digital models of ourselves. It's about me. I mean, talk to a young person. Talk to them about their goals. What do you want to be? What's your goal? I want to be famous. Really? Yep. I want to be famous. Saul was the same. So finally, Samuel chased Saul down, and we pick up again their conversation. When Samuel reached him, Saul said, "The Lord bless you." Now that's funny. He knew he disobeyed. Samuel, the Lord bless you. I've carried out the Lord's instructions. I'm blessed. So I can live like hell. I can pull a Purnell. Take that stride of pride. God bless me. No, it's not going to happen. Yet it's so interesting to hear people say, oh, I'm just blessed. As I said, they live like hell. No, you're not blessed. No. Don't take that concept in vain. You're not blessed. I read where Kris Jenner said she was blessed. Kris Jenner became a squillionaire because she marketed a porn tape of her daughter. No, she's not blessed. She's not blessed. Rappers aren't blessed. Talk about hoes and killing police and violence. No, they're not blessed. A-listers aren't blessed. No. Make these movies about all sorts of rebellion. Then they receive these awards at the shows that Hollywood puts on for themselves, which is interesting. And then they say, I'm blessed? Or you go to some concert? And they say, I'm blessed? No. Don't be putting a God sticker on something that's against his will and way. But That's what he said. I mean, here Saul had been disobedient. Oh, I'm blessed. I've carried out the Lord's instructions. Okay. So Samuel says this. He says, basically, Saul, who are you trying to please? Then he changes this conversation and he says, it's about obedience, Saul. You didn't obey the Lord. 95% obedience is still 5% short because Saul kept for himself King Agag and some of the plunder and some of the values. And then he tells Samuel, oh, and I'm going to dedicate that to the Lord. I'm God's man. And then Samuel says in verse 22, does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the voice of the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of ram. So the key to this is obedience. It's doing what God wants you to do. But Ed, if I only had an explanation, explain to me why I should fall under your authority. That's like when I got my teeth cleaned a couple of weeks ago. I walked in to the dentist's office. I'm under the authority of the dentist. He owns the practice and the hygienist. What if I said, don't touch my teeth until you explain to me everything you know about oral hygiene. Don't touch my teeth. I'd still be in that chair listening. If you're waiting for an explanation, many times that's never going to happen. But Mom, if you just explain to me, Dad, if you just broke it down. I didn't really get a lot of explanation from Coach Joe Williams at Florida State. He didn't explain to me time and time again why I rode the bench. He didn't. And then people say this, oh, I'm not gonna be under their authority until I respect them. You know, it's about respect. Probably, you're not going to respect most of the authority figures that you submit to. Again, if you're waiting for that, you're gonna wait a long, long time. I didn't respect my college coach in a lot of ways. He brought this Playboy bunny, his girlfriend, on all the road trips. Smoked the peace pipe. This is our coach. Some of you got that. We had no curfew, no real rules. We were a super talented team, except me. I think they gave me a scholarship because they knew I'd be a stabilizing force. But thank you. Lisa goes, that's not true. Thank you, honey. That's a great wife, isn't it? But God used him in my life to mold me into the man I am today. So if you're waiting for some explanation from your boss, your manager, your coach, or, man, I'm not going to respect them, I'm just not going to respect them. So because I don't respect them, I'm just going to do what I... No. You're probably not going to. It's about authority. But there's great freedom in this. So you see this struggle, don't you? This battle. And then, oh my goodness, 1 Samuel 15:23, this is just like, man, this will make you facepalm. For rebellion, he's talking to Saul, is as of the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and adultery. What? So when I'm rebellious, when I've pulled a Purnell, and when you have, we're more like the devil than at any other time in our lives. Ouch! That's not going to be on a coffee mug or a keychain or one of my shirts I designed. No, I'm not going to put that on there. But think about that. Because if we take that stride of pride and pull a Purnell, we'll end up, like Saul did, walking the streets in the cold. Because what I didn't tell you about the Florida State story with Purnell, I kind of left you hanging. Purnell walked out of the tunnel. Remember that? The game ends. We go to the locker room. The locker room is trashed. He destroyed it. Where's Purnell? No one knew. And no one even looked for him. We shower, dress, jump aboard the bus going from the arena to the hotel, and probably like 12 degrees outside. I'm sitting there, just looking out the window, dark streets of Cincinnati. And to my shock, I see someone in a Florida State uniform walking the streets of Cincinnati. Shoulders back. I go, there's Purnell. There's Purnell. And I won't get into the rest of the story. But when we pull a Purnell, we're going to be out in the elements. And that's what Saul ended up doing. Because let me tell you two more fast stories. Now I'm going to tell you the stories like I tell my grandkids. Quick stories, right before bed. You ready for this? So story one, the whiplash at Michmash, right? You got it? Okay. The bite of the Amalekites. Again, 95% obedience is still 5% obedience short. If you don't believe me, go home and tell your spouse, hey, I'm 95% faithful, babe. See how that works for you. I sound like Dr. Phil already. How's that working for you? Anyway. Here's another story, fast story, about David. Enter David. David now was anointed the new king of Israel. Whenever you have authority issues, and Saul had the opportunity to get it right, didn't he? You're just cheering for him. But he said, no, 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 no. God always will find a replacement player if we don't do his will. He'll find someone else to do what we're supposed to do. And that's what happened. David was anointed at 16 years of age, the new king of Israel. But David had to wait 15 years before he actually took the throne. 15 years of being under the authority of psycho Saul. How did he do it? Here's the quick story. Story three, David being brave in a cave. You ever been to Bucky's? Oh man, I love Bucky's. I met the owner of Bucky's a couple of years ago, went to his house. He's a great guy. David's running from Saul. Saul's jealous of David because David had just taken out Goliath. So Saul hired 3,000 Navy SEALs to go after David. David's running, and David just goes to Bucky's. He goes to this cave, and he's hiding in the cave. Saul, you won't believe this, is in high-speed pursuit. The Bible says Mother Nature tapped him on the shoulder. It's in the Bible. So Saul looks and he goes, I got to go to Bucky's too. Man, does Bucky's have some clean restrooms or what? And the food. So Saul goes into Bucky's to relieve himself. Now, I'm not going to be too descriptive here. Don't worry. So Saul is doing what he had to do. David is in the back. And he's looking. And David's mighty men say, David, you've got him now with his pants down. You can kill him. And the moment he dies, you're the new king. Come on, my man. David sneaks up to Saul, cuts a piece of his robe off, slithers back in the shadows, and then Saul leaves. Of course, he sees the sign, employees must wash hands. He washes his hands and he walks out. He walks down from the cave, and here's what David does. He waits for Saul to, you know, to reignite with his soldiers. And then David goes, hey, Saul, I could have killed you. Here's a piece of your robe. But I'm under your authority, my man. Unbelievable. Story 4. The champ in the camp. Saul is still chasing him. He can't get him. So Saul finds a KOA campground and he's asleep. And if you know anything about ancient history, the soldiers would surround the king while he slumbered. David, I don't know why David did this. David's kind of messing with him in a way. David sneaks up on him again through these sleeping soldiers. And his guys are like, David, you can kill Saul. All you got to do is take him out. You're the new king. 1 Samuel 26, 9 through 11. Whew. Don't destroy him. For who can lift a hand against the Lord's anointed and be blameless? This is David talking. David added, as the Lord lives, the Lord will certainly strike him down, which he did. Either his day will come and he will die, or he will go into battle and perish. However, here's the key phrase, because of the Lord, I will never lift my hand against the Lord's anointed. Why do you submit to your teacher or professor's authority? Because of the Lord. Why do you submit sometimes to your spouse? Because of the Lord. At work, and my boss is a jerk, because of the Lord. Parents and coaches and managers and CEOs and doctors and lawyers and pastors, because of the Lord. Why do I submit? Why do I struggle with it? Because it's who God is, and it's who the devil wanted to be. So we struggle with this. I mean, I want to pull a Purnell a lot, but when I stay in the game, I can't tell you what God does in my life. Okay. Man, my boss is unfair. Or this person, I feel like, you know, I just don't really dig it, and they have asked me to do something that is immoral, unbiblical. What do I do, Ed? You didn't answer that question. Well, the Bible encourages us three things. Number one, pray for the person. Number two, sit down and explain to them your convictions And then number three, present a creative alternative. And if they're still pushing you to do something non-biblical, then you say, bye-bye. It's that simple. But what I just said is an exception more than the rule. I know what you're thinking right now, because I'm thinking the same thing. That's why I know what you're thinking. You're going, oh, Ed, man, what interesting stories about these biblical icons. I mean, you just described an epic battle between Samuel and Saul, David and Saul. Whoa. Well, if you think that, that's not quite it. You're not quite there. Because there's a deeper battle going on. This battle is really Samuel versus Samuel, Saul versus Saul, David versus David, and you versus you. Authority issues. Let's pray. Father, it's my earnest prayer that if there's someone here, and we all struggle with this, who's really going through this pull, I pray that you would see the brilliance and the beauty of the authority of God. Others here, if you've never submitted your life to Jesus, you can do so by simply saying this. Just say this with me to yourself. Just say, God, I'm a sinner. I turn from my sins and turn to you. I believe you sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross, to rise again on the third day. And right now, I receive you into my life. Forgive me, cleanse me. I want to live in the shade of your success. God, we thank you for this time and ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi guys, thank you so much for watching the Ed Young YouTube channel.
That's right, and if you want to be inspired, encouraged, and challenged like never before, subscribe and click the notification button.
We believe this channel can help change your life.